Holy Spirit, you drive us out into the wilderness. But let us know why. What are we to find? Amen. A couple of years ago, around this time, my mom and I received an interesting invitation to lead a mother-daughter retreat for a group of UCC women in New Jersey. And as my mom and I were kind of thinking through this invitation, were we up for this kind of collaboration, which felt pretty big, I remember my mom just pointing out, let's do it, and let's call it Into the Woods. And that felt like some sort of Holy Spirit moment, inspiration, and I kind of said, I don't know why we're calling it Into the Woods, Mom. Sure, let's do it. So as we dove into that theme, I first of all learned that she was indeed on an Into the Woods kick at the time, listening to the soundtrack on every car ride that she was on. And secondly, she was indeed on to something. For as we thought about that theme, Into the Woods, we began wondering together, what are the examples in art, in literature, in our own Holy Scriptures, where characters are driven into the woods, and what is it that happens there? Once we asked ourselves that question, the answer started just rolling in. We thought about Thoreau at Walden. We thought about Hansel and Gretel. We thought of Shakespeare's A Midsummer Night's Dream, and even this ominous-sounding children's song, The Teddy Bear's Picnic, when you go into the woods today, all started rushing into our minds. And if you know that song, I'm sorry, because it might be stuck in there for the next couple of days, as it has been for me. In each of these examples, a journey into the wilderness is a deeply transformational undertaking. It's often filled with identities that are being shed, that are being found. It's a journey of isolation and of loneliness. It's a journey of temptation. And as we see again and again, as that experience concludes, there's oftentimes some sort of metaphorical death that sits right alongside a metaphorical birth. And so as we sit here together on this snowy Sunday and we begin this liturgical season of Lent, perhaps it's becoming clear to you that here within our own tradition also lies quite a wilderness journey. Every year, right here at the beginning of Lent, we are reminded of the wilderness time of Jesus, the time that is sandwiched right between his baptism and the beginning of his ministry. A time of, maybe you guessed it, identities being shed and found, isolation and loneliness, temptation. And as the experience concludes, awaiting us at Holy Week, a death and a birth that sit right alongside one another. So each year on this first Sunday of Lent, we are reminded of that story. And it's often the case in our scripture, each book in the Gospels tells the story in a somewhat different way. This year, we've heard the version from the Gospel of Mark. This is a version that is unique because of its brevity. There's practically no information about what this wilderness looked like in this version. We don't really know what it felt like in this version. We don't really know what it contained. We hear that it happened. We hear that Jesus was accompanied by both wild beasts and angels. And we hear that when it was over, his public ministry began. So I think that the gift of this brief and somewhat bare-bones version that Mark gives us, it invites us into deeper imagination for ourselves, because we are left to fill in the gaps. We can fill in those gaps, perhaps through literature, through song, perhaps our own experience of those wilderness journeys. For in Mark's version, we are invited to imagine what a wilderness time might look like, what it might feel like. And there's no one there to tell us directly what we should be thinking or feeling. We are invited to open our minds to the other stories of wilderness journeys that we may have taken ourselves or that we may have heard about in other ways. So, here enter T.S. Eliot's poem, Journey of the Magi. In a few minutes, we'll have the beautiful and unique opportunity to transition ourselves out of the season of Epiphany and into the season of Lent by considering the Magi's visit to Jesus through a uniquely Lenten lens. Through the words of T.S. Eliot's poetry and the sounds of our own beloved Newell Hendricks composition, today we as a congregation are invited to take a story that we might think that we know well, that of those three wise ones visiting the baby Jesus, and instead today we're showcasing it from a completely different and decidedly more Lenten angle. The journey of the Magi, as told through T.S. Eliot and Newell Hendricks, lifts up the reality that for those Magi traveling to the manger, their journey may indeed have been a grim and difficult wilderness journey. More exhausting, more isolating, filled with temptation, more so than perhaps we had ever considered before. Now, when I instinctively think about the Magi's visit, particularly as a young girl being in Sunday school class, I was taught to quickly rattle off the gifts that the Magi brought to Jesus. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. I'm guessing that it likely rolls off your tongue as quickly as it does mine. But it wasn't until this poem that I began to ask myself, wait a second, we know what it is that the Magi brought to Jesus. We've rehearsed that many times. But what was the gift that Jesus gave to the Magi? What was the impact of Jesus on those wealthy and powerful ones who traveled all that way? What was the result of their wilderness journey? This poem and the musical rendering that we'll soon hear shows us that perhaps it was actually the Magi who were given the ultimate gift, something far better than gold, frankincense, or myrrh. For the end of their wilderness journey, as they reflect back on all that had transpired, it seems that they are left with a worldview and a perspective that is forever transformed. T.S. Eliot puts it in words far better than I ever could have. He writes, "We returned to our places, these kingdoms, but no longer at ease here in the old dispensation, with an alien people clutching their gods." This feeling of unease, this feeling of restlessness with the way that things are, perhaps that is one of the most transformative, if unpleasant, gifts of our Christian faith. In writing about this very poem, former Archbishop of Canterbury, Rowan Williams, remarked, T.S. Eliot never wanted to present religious faith as a nice, cheerful answer to everyone's questions, but as a deep inner shift, an inner shift so deep that you could hardly recognize it, yet giving a new perspective on everything and a new restlessness in the tired and chilly world. An inner shift so deep that you could hardly notice it, yet giving a new perspective on everything. Perhaps those Magi journeying through the dark of night to a manger in a land so far away was one of the earliest wilderness stories of Jesus' lifetime. And so, on this first Sunday in Lent, when the Gospel of Mark invites us to enter the wilderness for 40 days, perhaps we can take inspiration from those Magi who went before us, showing us but one sacred example of the power of a wilderness journey. And while it may be true what Little Red Riding Hood repeats on her own journey into the woods, for she sings again and again, "The woods are just trees. The trees are just woods." But what happens when we are in them can be the heart of our Christian experience. An inner shift so deep that you can hardly notice it, yet giving a new perspective on everything.